And finally tonight, in running Kruger news, we have a follow-up to our ongoing story of how voting works. Just in case anyone missed it, a while back, I put a post on Facebook asking if anyone with an advanced degree in political science was not planning on voting for the Democratic nominee in the general election, and for those people to send me an email explaining their reasoning. That was on March 10th, so it's been about 7 weeks. Let me just count them up. I have zero responses from that group. Zero is the number. But I'm still seeing plenty of that argument from lots of people who are not experts on political science. So we're going to talk about it. And I know we've been doing that a lot. Maybe you're getting tired of hearing it, but we're doing it a lot because it's super, super important. The outcome of the election in November is one of the most important political events that'll happen in our lifetime. We're in the middle of a global crisis that can only be solved by science, and we have a science-denying bigot in power. And on top of the climate change problem, we have a global pandemic of coronavirus. This election is kind of a big deal.
Not even going to pretend this is related to a news story, are you, Heath?
Just a lot of stories. Yeah, he could have pointed out that teenage fundamentalists who think the Earth is 6,000 years old and, again, who aren't allowed to wear hats are running major sections of the executive branch. That's a related story.
It's a follow-up on that story and how, you know, you might be able to behave in a way that fixes some of that. We'll see. So it seems like a decent amount of people listening right now aren't clear on how they're going to be voting in the general election. And that's a big problem. So we're not going to let this go. Here's the reality. If every person who aligns more with, for example, Hillary Clinton than they do with Donald Trump, if those people had voted for Hillary Clinton in 2016, we'd have a Supreme Court that does not think gerrymandering is a perfectly constitutional thing that each state gets to do if they want. And that consequence could last for decades. Protest voting just from 2016 set the country back decades. There's no talking around that. And that's just one of so many disastrous consequences of Donald Trump already. We might get more years of him.
Yeah.
So here's what we're asking. We need you to do the ultimate skeptical thing. We need you to hear a logical argument that challenges your current position and for you to modify your thinking. And I understand how difficult that can be when you hear an argument against your position, especially in politics, because experts don't count in politics for some reason. When you hear that, though, your instinct is to immediately form counterarguments. That's normal. That's what everyone, myself included, will naturally do. But try to rise above that, just as a mental exercise right now, and hear us out for the length of this little segment. And rather than forming counterarguments in your head as you hear it, just listen and try to understand the opposing view. You can always do counterarguments later.
So many people who are just forming counterarguments to that proposal rather than listening right now, it's pretty crazy.
Help me out here for a minute, right? Is sharing that meme, you know, the one with the guy looking over his girlfriend's shoulder when someone in Moscow has written DNC over the other girl. God. That's what we're calling forming a counterargument, right?
Oh, yeah. In 2020?
Well, don't do that. That's not what I meant. But don't do that either. Yeah. So we're going to start with a simple pros and cons thing. If you're considering a protest vote or a non-vote, you see an upside to that strategy. But if you're being intellectually honest, you must also realize there's a downside. But you're thinking the pros outweigh the cons. Problem is your scale is broken, or you forgot to put some enormous cons on the negative side. For example, you're thinking that a loss for Joe Biden will send a message to Democratic voters in a future primary that we need a more progressive candidate. Now, that's a good goal. I want that too. I want a more progressive candidate than Joe Biden. But I'm going to outweigh that pro by nearly infinity with Ruth Bader Ginsburg possibly getting replaced by a conservative theocratic bigot. That could happen.
And look, it not just could happen. We know who it will be. It will be 37-year-old Justin Walker, you know, the guy I made cry during our debate. Yeah, he's about to be elevated to the U.S. Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit, which you may recognize as Merrick Garland's court.
I'm not familiar with that name, Merrick Garland.
The bench for the Supremes. He was rated a unanimous not qualified by the American Bar Associations. Cool. He has watched fewer depositions than Thomas Smith. He's about to be a Supreme Court justice.
To be fair, Jesus it was Christ. Lovely of Thomas to come support me like that in my deposition. It was really.
Yeah, I thought the foam finger was a bit much. Anyway.
Really?
Again, these problems that I'm talking about, they last for decades, especially the court ones. And the effect is enormous. It's not even close. The speculative value of maybe affecting a future Democratic primary pales in comparison to that definite thing I just described. And we'll talk about just how speculative that is in a second. But one other point on the Supreme Court. It could easily be more than one justice getting replaced next term. The entire court is over 50 years old, and the entire liberal wing of the court is going to be over 60 for the next president. Two of those liberals are in their 80s. Any of these people could die or need to retire at any moment. So any protest voter needs to consider that as a giant negative factor to weigh against whatever you believe is the positive in that speculative universe you got going. Again, it's not even close.
And if this hasn't hit home, even if there is a giant blue wave in 2020, and I actually do believe there will be a giant blue wave in 2020, a tremendous amount of that progress that could happen from that blue wave will definitionally be held up by the Supreme Court. There will be multiple progressive policies that non-voters / third-party voters didn't vote or voted third-party because of that will not happen or will be slowed by the court created by their non-vote or third-party vote.
Yes, absolutely. A lot of people are talking about voting, okay, I'm going to vote for down-ballot progressives, but I'm going to skip the presidential part of that. But that person has to sign the things that those down-ballot progressives might do.
They do.
You got to pay attention to this. And here's the other huge factor you're ignoring or weighing incorrectly, in my opinion. The pro that you're assuming, a Biden loss providing a lesson, that doesn't even work.
This should
heavily impact your thinking. Look at what happened in 2016. We saw plenty of protest votes and non-votes by progressives. And in theory, those people were hoping Democrats would learn a lesson and a candidate like Bernie Sanders would do better in the next primary. But he did not. He actually did noticeably worse, despite having much more national recognition this time around. The lesson never happened. The opposite happened. I would have loved to see this lesson happen. It didn't happen.
Not only did the opposite happen, the entire dialogue has shifted, right? Bernie and his supporters managed to garner tremendous support and move the conversation left in 2016 until the non-voting / third party voting happened, at which point the conversation, by necessity, switched to people voting correctly, including on this fucking podcast. We literally cannot cover other issues or get into the minutiae of differences of policy on the left because of the fear that we might not spend enough time convincing people to vote at all.
Yeah.
And by the way, Bernie moved the national conversation either way. That's good. But we still obviously need not Trump to be the president when we talk about anything moving forward with progressive policies. That's just so obvious. So now that we're on the subject of that teaching a lesson theory, I want to talk about two arguments I've heard side by side from the same person many times. Argument one, progressive non-voters and third-party voters from 2016 are not to blame for Hillary losing. It was the fault of the Democrats and the DNC for not electing a more progressive candidate in the primary. That argument is pretty much guaranteed to come out almost every time.
I hear it all the time. It is baffling to me. So listen up. This is not about assigning blame. You know who's to blame for Trump being president? Trump voters, right? Racist morons. But you know who doesn't listen to our shows? Racist morons, right? So look, are we cool with that now? We're not saying this is all your fault. We're not trying to blame you. We're trying to shame you into not doing a thing that helps out racist morons.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, I'm blaming. Like, Andrew's being nice.
Two-thirds of us are not.
Like, obviously, Trump voters are evil, but you helped that. You share some of the blame, and I'll explain. Here's the second argument that I was talking about that I hear side by side to that first one. It goes something like this. Non-voting or third-party voting, and making Hillary Clinton or Joe Biden lose the general election, is the only way to teach the Democrats to cater to progressive values in the future. Again, just about every single progressive who's talking about not voting blue has invoked both of these arguments. But think about them together for a second. They directly contradict. Either protest votes can take away a victory, or they cannot take away a victory. If they can, then progressives who didn't vote for Hillary Clinton can share some of the blame for Trump's victory. If that's you, Trump was your intended goal at that moment, and it worked. So of course you share some of the blame for the downsides that go along with what you saw as the upsides. On the other hand, if protest voters cannot take away a victory from a Democrat, then withholding votes doesn't change the outcome, and there won't be any teaching of lessons. And just in case anyone missed it, the answer is yes, withholding votes can and did change the outcome in 2016. If the Jill Stein votes in Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, and Michigan went to Hillary instead, they were enough to win the Electoral College. So those voters can be told that they share the blame. Yes, well, absolutely.
Technically, you're blaming math there.
So. Oh, okay. Yeah, sorry. Right. No, I should blame the a priori existence of numbers and how that goes. Yeah.
Numbers. And again, more importantly, those numbers could be outweighed by people who just showed up. Right. When I've made that argument, many people have made the argument that, like, oh, you know, a certain percentage of Green Party voters aren't disaffected Democrats, but like true believing third party wackos. And like that might be true. But again, all it would take is an incredibly small percentage of the people who didn't bother voting in those states to outweigh those that, even if we concede it, are too willfully ignorant to vote correctly.
Sure, let's get way more turnout, and absolutely correct, that could be an outweighing number, but let's also not get people voting wrong. If right. you align more with one of the two candidates, you should vote for that candidate. That's what
both.
Voting in a general election means.
Yeah.
Anyway, circling back, that pair of arguments that I was talking about gets even worse when you realize that, again, there was no teaching of a lesson. In the 2020 primary, Bernie got less support against Biden than he got against Hillary. So it turns out both of those arguments are bad. But it's literally impossible for both arguments to be good. They contradict. And both get invoked just about every time I've had this argument.
Yeah. And I want to point out another thing. And it may seem off topic, but it's not. The thing that the far right and the far left share is the idea that bad things happen and there's nothing you can really do about it. Right? It's why a lot of people on the far left claim to be Marxists, right? Pure Marxists, pure socialists, pure communists. Now, whether or not you believe those ideologies to be failed in themselves, and I actually think there's an argument to be made that they are, if the only acceptable outcome for you is for the non-existent working class to seize the non-existent means of production, because the closest you've come to studying poli-sci is a 33-page booklet made for Turner to Century okay. beet farmers,
I want have things, but I've read more than the little book. Right. Anyway, go ahead.
But when that's all you've read, you have no problem refusing the lesser of two evils, because everything that isn't your exact hypothetical revolution is unsatisfactory, and that's an idea that needs to be dropped.
Yeah, and by the way, just to be clear about my personal opinion, and I think you guys would agree with me, I think you guys are not at all happy with Biden as the nominee. You would have had a whole bunch of other better choices, no?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
Right. So nothing I'm saying right now is meant to defend Biden. All I'm saying is that he's obviously better than Trump. It's not even close. It's not even remotely close. Read the platform, by the way. So many people get in this argument. I'm like, oh, did you read the whole platform? Clearly they hadn't. So a few of them got back to me and were like, oh, yeah, the platform is better than I thought. Read the platform. But if you read that platform and then still can't tell the difference between Joe Biden and Donald Trump, or just can't tell the difference between Democrats and Republicans right now, you're extremely stupid or you're a liar.
Yeah.
There's differences.
And to add on to that, Joe Biden is fine. Look, I don't agree with him on everything, but I agree with him on more than I disagree with him. In fact, in order to find things he and I really disagree on, we have to talk about things he used to believe. And if there's anything you'd think the audience of this show would understand, it would be being a former haver of bad ideas, wouldn't you? Right? But more importantly, and again, I speak to the left here, he is representative of what the literal numerical majority of this country's left stands for. I don't like that. I don't want that to be the case, but that is the case. And if we want that to change, we have to vote. Not talk shit on Twitter, not write us snarky emails, vote and win.
Yeah,
that's how you make that change.
And let me underscore those points, Eli. Joe Biden has a lifetime ranking from the American Conservative Union of 12.67. Okay, that means he votes for conservative positions 12 2/3% of the time, right? And picking a senator at random, how about this B. Sanders from Vermont? His lifetime rating is 6.78. Okay, and again, I want to use a precise legal term here. Stop saying stupid shit like Joe Biden is conservative or worse, Joe Biden is a closet Republican. No, Joe Manchin is a conservative Democrat. He's a 27. Republicans, Susan Collins is a 45. Lisa Murkowski is a 58. Ted Cruz, not making this up, is a 98.25. Right?
Good for
Joe
him.
Biden's a 12. Okay, look, I backed Elizabeth Warren. I wanted somebody way, way, way to the left of 12. But let's not pretend that 12 is 50 or 98.
Also, fun fact, unrelated, also a 12 on my hot or not meter. So, you know.
Wait, what's the scale on that?
10.
1 to 10.
And by the way, funny feeling Donald Trump would have a higher number than 12 2/3 if he had a legislative history to yeah. rate on.
Yeah.
Funny feeling.
Yeah.
And those are our two choices, whether we like it or not. Yeah. All that being said, none of this means we can't talk about problems in the Democratic Party or flaws in Joe Biden. They certainly exist. No question. But that stuff is irrelevant to the choice in November unless every problem with Biden and the Democratic Party is viewed in direct contrast to Trump and the Republican Party every time when we're talking about November. As long as we have a two-party system, and I don't like it either, but as long as that's the reality, discussions about voting in the general have to maintain the context of the two options. Just pointing out, here's a problem with Biden or a problem with the Democratic Party is meaningless without a comparison against the alternative. And the alternative doesn't just last for 4 years. Again, many of Trump's actions are going to last for decades. And they hurt the exact people who a true progressive claims to be fighting for. And if you feel like you're being held hostage by this process somehow, it's a phrase I've heard a bunch of times. You're feeling that because you are, but you're not being held hostage by the DNC. You're being held hostage by doing the right thing and choosing less harm. That hostage feeling is called ethics. And yes, you are bound by it all the time. The events that led you to be stuck in a trolley dilemma don't change the right answer about flipping the fucking switch.
Yeah, I think it's abhorrent that anyone would tie someone to the railroad tracks in the first place and meow.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Bottom line, if you're a progressive who's not planning to vote for Joe Biden, or even worse, you're also spreading that misguided opinion, you're literally helping the cause of Russian intelligence.
Yeah.
You might have a noble rationale in your head, but regardless of your intention, you are, as a point of fact, helping the cause of Russian spies. And you're not even getting paid. You're an unwitting Russian spy intern. Stop it. Be better.
Yeah, and to that point, I want to talk about this. I think a lot of people who express these ideas, especially on social media, it's less about believing them, and it's more about intellectually and publicly playing with them. And so, a great example, I was back on Twitter for about 45 seconds a couple weeks ago, and someone tweeted at me, what's a reason besides guilt to vote for Joe Biden? And so I listed some that I listed on the show, and then some then, and it was a perfectly polite conversation. But what happened was it turned into one of those person who wasn't the original question asker replying to the reply to the reply thing.
Yeah, and Twitter's great for discourse. Yeah,
right, exactly. And that person sort of maintained the two ideas that Heath addressed above. And when Heath, who also was in that conversation, presented the arguments he presented here, they answered, yeah, I don't know. I guess I was just kind of feeling kind of cranky the other day. I'm going to vote blue. And look, I get it. I have been cranky on Twitter. Lord knows. It's why I'm not there anymore. But what that person, and I think a lot of the people who get on social media to express these ideas, don't realize is that everyone who saw that conversation did not see the ending, right? Maybe that conversation had anonymously on a public forum convinced someone to vote third party or not vote. So even if you feel like you're just expressing frustration or blowing off steam, you gotta be mindful of who might be listening.
Yeah, and stay in context, right?
Yeah, while we're talking about Twitter, I shared out a story this past weekend on the Opening Arguments Twitter feed about four Democratic congressmen who literally signed a GOP letter to ask Steve Mnuchin to open up PPP loans to payday lenders, right?
What?
So, Jesus. Yeah, if you care at all about working people, you want payday lenders ground up into a powder and shot into the sun, right? And look, unlike stupid hashtags, this is something you can actually do something about, right? These are sitting congressmen. They have to run for re-election like every couple of weeks. They're Democrats. You can call their offices and they will talk to you, right? These are precisely the sort of people you should be lobbying if you want to drag the Democratic Party to the left. And so I shared out the story and I said, if you're represented by any of these four congressmen, call their offices. But then I looked and realized I was the only person sharing out the story. And I asked us in an Eli moment of being cranky on Twitter, what do you think the ratio of time that lefty sources spend on this story versus retweeting out more anti-Biden hit pieces? Turns out so far that ratio is infinity because, yeah, they're not covering the payday loan story. So I want you to think about that. I think this dovetails nicely with Eli's point. If you listen to, and I'm going to call them out specifically, Kyle Kalinske or the Young Turks, you had to learn about this story from us, from the twice monthly dick joke podcast, instead of your daily source of news about the left. So maybe, just maybe, they're not really about fighting for working people.
Oh. Yeah. Or maybe they mean to be, honestly, and they're just not very good at it. Maybe that's what it is. I think everybody I'm trying to talk to during this whole segment, we're on the same, like, good team philosophically. I think that's an important point to make. We agree with each other on what a lot of the goals are, but not how to get there. And I promise you, I have a better understanding of how to get there than you if you don't think you should vote for the Democrat in November. I promise you. And post bottom line, I said this last episode, but I'm going to repeat it again. Bernard Sanders agrees with me. So don't take my word for it. And don't take Eli's word or Noah's word. And don't take Andrew's word, you know, just because he's super intelligent and knowledgeable and studied the stuff at the highest level with some of the best professors in the world. Well, that stuff doesn't count. Take the word of the guy who's inspiring your protest vote. Or maybe you know more about progressive politics than Bernie Sanders. Do ya? If you do, you can ignore everything we just said.
Don't ignore everything he just said.
Great.
Yeah, even if you know more about progressive politics than Bernie Sanders, don't. No.
And you don't.